Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God for this wonderful time that He has given us to come into His presence to hear from the Word of God. I'll just read a few verses from Mark chapter 12, verses 28 onwards. And one of the scribes came up and heard them disputing with one another. And seeing that he answered them well, asked him, which commandment is the most important of all? Jesus answered, the most important is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second of this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment, no other commandment greater than this. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this wonderful evening time that you've given us to gather in your presence. Thank you for this wonderful day that you've given us, Lord. As we come into your presence, Lord, to hear from your word, I pray that, Lord, Holy Spirit will speak to us. Lord, open our understanding, open our minds, Lord, open our ears, so that we will be attentive, Lord, to your word, and we will be ready to accept, Lord, what you want to tell us, what the Spirit wants to speak to us, Lord. Lord, I pray that, Lord, each and everyone sitting here, including me, Lord, we will be receptive of your will in our life, Lord. All glory and honor be to you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I think we already, got a lot of message today, from the how many of you, I don't know, were watching the videos that we, the pre-service videos, and then Joshua spoke quite a bit, then through the songs. I don't know how many of you followed the lyrics of the songs. All were so powerful, and they were all speaking to us if you are paying attention to the lyrics. Wondering what else is there, but let's sit in the presence of God. I don't have an option to just let you go like this. I have to speak from the word. So let's come into this the portion where we see a encounter or a conversation between a group of religious leaders and Jesus. Them asking a question and Jesus answering them. And throughout the gospel, we see many times the religious leaders coming and trying to trick Jesus with questions and somehow trap him and arrest him. That is what they were trying many times. Even in that chapter, if we go read the previous portions, we see them asking multiple questions. And one Pharisees and then Sadducees, they were all asking these different questions. I don't want to go into details of that. But here, we see this in Matthew as well, Matthew chapter 22, verse 34, where in the previous portions, we see Jesus silence the Sadducees. And we see that when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. So they, again, like they are gathering together, somehow trying to trick Jesus. So one of these guys who is identified as a scribe or a lawyer is asking this question to test Jesus, which commandment is the most important of all. So we see a scribe or a lawyer, and lawyer even during that time, even during now, lawyers always try to ask trick questions. I'm talking about India, not here. Maybe it's like that here too. They're trying to trick, Jesus. And who is this scribe who is asking this question? And we'll look at scribes are the ones who studied the word of God, studied the law diligently, not only to detect scribal errors, but also to understand the meaning of the scriptures. So after the exile, we see the role of the scribes expanded. They not only studied copies of the scriptures to the synagogues, but they not only supplied copies of scriptures to the synagogues, but they also became teachers of the law. They would teach the law in the synagogues. We see one such scribe, Joji was going through in Nehemiah, right? Ezra was a scribe or a teacher of law. We see that in Nehemiah chapter 8, verses 9.
These people were very knowledgeable in the scriptures. They were also part of the Sanhedrin, which was the highest legal and administrative body that governed the Jewish life. So this particular person who's asking this question is not an ordinary guy. He knows very well the scriptures, and he's asking this question, what is the greatest commandment of all? So his purpose is not very pure. He's trying with an intention to trick Jesus. But he is not realizing who is sitting in front of him, right? Who is the person to whom he is asking this question? He doesn't know him well. If he was a knowledgeable and powerful guy who knew the scripture so well, the person who is sitting in front of him was the all-powerful, all-knowing God himself sitting in front of him. And he was asking this question to him, and the one who gave the law to them, that person is asking this question. Since they don't have that understanding, they don't have an understanding of who really Jesus is, and they are trying to reject the Messiah that they are seeing in front of them. They're trying to trick him. Out of the Mosaic law, there are around 613 commandments, and out of which we know the prominent ones are the Ten Commandments. When they were asking this question, they were expecting an answer from one of these Ten Commandments, but on the contrary, Jesus gave an answer which is the most important, or which is the crux of what the law is all about, or what you need to do. What is God expecting from his people? The one which will result in an automatic obedience to the commandments of God and the scriptures. Jesus here is quoting from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4. Where Moses is telling the Israel, hear, O Israel, Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might. So here we see it starts with the word hear, O Israel. The Hebrew word for hear is Shema, which is... The Hebrew word means to hear and obey. It's not just to hear and obey. This Shema is like a centerpiece of the daily morning and evening prayer services. So they have these prayer services where they would pray. It was a part of their prayers. It is an affirmation of who God is and God's kingship, and they would daily recite this. And the first verse of Shema is considered the most essential declaration of their faith, which says that Lord is our God and the Lord is one. The passage following that, the details which tells about how the faith should be lived, how they should live their life of trusting in God, which starts with telling that love God with everything, love God with all your being. And they were reciting this every morning and evening. But it has become such a, many times we also do a lot of things, like routines, right? But it becomes so common that we forget what is the importance of that. And that is what happened to these people also. They are reciting this every morning and evening, but they are not really understanding and doing it. It became like a routine. It became like a daily thing that they are doing, and they would pride in that we are doing that, we are reciting this. They would recite it with children, and they do all that, but still they were focusing just on doing certain things, just on showing certain things that I'm doing this, I'm doing that, I'm doing. So it was all show. So what does this mean? What Jesus is telling is, hear, O Israel, Lord, our God. There is no one besides him. It is talking about the lordship of God. It is talking about the lordship of God. The Hebrew word for Lord here is Yahweh, which is YHWH. It is built on the word I am, where God appeared to Moses, God said, I am. Moses asked, what should I tell the people that, who are you? God said, I am is sending you. So it means that he always exists. He's the one who exists. He exists in the past. He exists in the present. He exists in the future. There is no existence. There is no other existence without God. Without God, there is no existence for us. So this divine name of Yahweh, it was too sacred for them to utter. So what they did is they would replace vocally in synagogue when they recite those, they replaced it with the Hebrew word Adonai, which means my Lord. Adonai means my Lord, which was translated in the Greek language as Lord. So it is my Lord. So every time they would recite this in synagogues, they would say that, God, you are my Lord, Adonai, my master. So many times, they were focusing on, most of the times they were focusing on the aspect that he is one. That God is one. We serve a monotheistic God, right? All other, other nations or the Gentiles, they have so many gods, but we have one God. That is what they would pride in many times. But the aspect here was not just that, right? The aspect here, what God is telling them is, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. That he is your Lord. He is your Adonai. He is the one. He is the one. That is what he is, the master of my life. He is the controller of my life. Adonai word is used many times in many other places also in the Old Testament. We see some people referring kings as Adonai. We see David referring to Saul as Adonai, like master. So it was Adonai means a relationship between a master and a slave, where the slave, what it implies for the slave is that every decision in the slave's life is controlled by the master. The slave doesn't have his own will. Everything for the slave is controlled by the master. The master owns whatever the slave has. The slave's wives, the slave's children, everything is owned by the master. The master cares for his need, but the main thing here is he doesn't have a control on his life. His life is controlled by the master. So we see here that the scribe, this guy who is asking the question, he actually interpreted it very well. When Jesus answered the question to him, we see in Mark chapter 12 verses 32, see that the scribe said to him, you are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one and there is no other besides him. So Jesus didn't say that like that, right? He is interpreting it and he's saying that there is no other besides him. There is no one besides our God. There is no one else but him. He is the Lord. He is the one master of our life. There is no one else but God, right? That is what he interpreted it as, and that's so such a wonderful revelation he got, saying that he is the one, there is no one besides him. We read in Exodus chapter 20, where when God is publicly giving the Ten Commandments, God is, before he's publicly telling them the Ten Commandments, telling this in Exodus chapter 20 verses 2, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. Now, God is specifically telling them that, I am the Lord. I am the Lord your God. Directly, God is telling to the people that I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. After this, God is giving all those commandments. God is telling that you should have no other gods before him. You should not have idols and all those, all the commandments he's giving. And what is happening after that? We see Moses is going up the mountain to spend time with God, to receive the commandments, to receive all the details of the tabernacle and all that. And when they don't see Moses for a long time, these people become restless, right? These people become restless. And we see in Exodus chapter 32, verses 1, when the people saw that Moses delayed to come from the mountain, the people gathered themselves together to Aaron and said to him, "Up, make us gods who shall go before us. And as for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." What did God tell them in 20? "I am the Lord who brought you out of Egypt." What are the people telling now? "We don't know. Moses is the one who brought us out of Egypt. We don't know what has become of him." So, who was their master? Who was their master? Their master was still Moses. Their Lord was still Moses. And that was the problem that led to that idol worship that during that time. So as a new covenant believer, if you are saved, there is an important part in the confession, right? Which Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, my Lord, believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Many times our focus is on, oh, Jesus died for me, Jesus saved me, right? So I am and I am justified, and all that things we take. But we forget the part about what? That he is my Lord. So what does it say? If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, Jesus is my Lord. He is my Adonai. He is my Adonai. So what does it mean is that we don't belong to us anymore. We belong to Jesus. This is what Paul is advising the church of Corinth. The church of Corinth had this problem. 1 Corinthians 3 verses 22, he's telling, you know, you don't belong to Paul or Apollos or Cephas, who is Peter. You are Christ. You belong to Christ. There are people who are saying that I belong to Peter. I belong to this guy. I belong to that guy. Paul is telling that you don't belong to anyone. All of yours, everything belongs to Christ. There is no one but Christ. So if you have accepted Jesus in your life, if you have made him the Lord of your life, this is one thing that we need to understand, that he is the Lord. That you have made him master over your life. Everything that you have is his. Hallelujah. Everything that we have belongs to whom? Jesus. Hallelujah. But one important thing here is this, you know, lordship is not a forced one. This lordship is not like a master coming and capturing a slave from one place. It's not like Joseph being forced to go into Potiphar's house and being a slave in Potiphar's house. It's not like that. This is a lordship. The basis of this lordship is love. The basis of this lordship is love. And that is the most important factor of our relationship with God. Our relationship with this God is based on love. If it is not based on love, if our relationship with God is not based on love, then as we saw in the pre-service video, everything else is of nothing. As we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, that if I speak with tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I'm a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and knowledge, and I have all faith so as to remove mountains but have no love, I am nothing. I will give all I have, and even if I deliver my body to be burned but don't have any love, I gain nothing. So if our relationship with God is not based on love,
then everything else is a waste. The singing that we do, the worship that we do, the going to church that we do, the, you know, preaching that we do, the gifts, you may have, you want to have gifts, you operate in gifts, you may be, you may be having healing ministry, or you may having this and that, but if there is no love, if it is not based out of love, everything else is waste. That is the problem that even Jesus was pointed out, that Jesus was telling about, or Jesus was warning about that in Matthew chapter 24 verses 12. Jesus is telling that because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. It will grow cold. This is the world that we are living in. As the time goes by, as the things that we see around in the world, the temptations, the things that is that we see around the world, that everything is growing cold. And even in the churches, we see how things are, that love is growing cold. And that's what Jesus said, the love of many will grow cold. He's talking about the people of God only. The love of many will grow cold. And Jesus addresses this problem to the church of Ephesus, the one church who suffered so much for Christ, who stood so much for Christ. If you read Ephesians, we see Paul telling so many good things about Ephesians, what good things they did. They were so faithful to God. But we see that Jesus is pointing out to that church that I have this thing against you, that you have abandoned the love that you had at first. And Jesus is telling them to come back to that love. Jesus addresses this problem with Peter as well. When he's going to Peter in John chapter 21, we know that portion very well, that Jesus is going and asking him, do you love me three times? Jesus is, telling him three times he's asking, do you love me? And at the end, Jesus says this. After this, Jesus tells him, truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will dress you and carry you when you do not want to go. And this to show by what kind of death he was to glorify God. And after that, he said to him, follow me. Peter was very excited to follow Jesus. We see in the beginning, he saw a great miracle, the great catch of fish, and he left everything and followed Jesus. So it was so exciting to follow Jesus. He declared Jesus as the Son of, as the Christ, Son of Living God, when everybody was saying something else about Jesus. He's the one who got that revelation. He got the privilege to walk on the water with Jesus. We talk about him, drowning. But who walked on water other than Jesus among all the disciples? This guy had the guts or had the faith in Jesus to do that, to take that step to walk on the water. This is the guy who had so much experiences. He had the privilege to see Jesus transfigured. But Jesus is telling, all these experiences are good, Peter. But that is not what is the basis of you following me. The miracles are all good. I have done another great miracle for you here at this time, another great catch of fish. But you following me is not on the basis of the miracle that I did. You following me is on the basis of love. Do you love me? Do you love me? It is not on the basis of the glorious sight that you saw on the Mount of Transfiguration. It's not on the basis of that. It's on the basis of love. Do you love me? That is why Jesus is telling him that, if it is now you are being restored, now you are going to follow me on the basis of love. Now it will be completely in my control. You know, I will control your life, that everything will be according to my will, that I will take you in the ways where I want to go. The other important point is, what is the source of this love? The source of this love is God Himself. The source of this love is no one but God. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 7, it says, Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. Anyone who does not love God does not know God, for God is love. God is love. That is His nature. That is His very being. That is His character. And our God is not someone whose character just says there and says that I am the God, I am God is love, I am love. And He doesn't say, stay there. But He's the one who demonstrated that for us. In 1 John 4 verses 9, again it says, In this the love of God was made manifest among us. Or it was demonstrated to us that God sent His only Son into this world that we might live through Him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be a propitiation for our sins. It's the love that He demonstrated us, not the love that the world is showing, as we saw in the pre-service videos. It is not that the world is going to show tomorrow by different ways. It is a love that He demonstrated for us. That is the true love. By giving Himself for us, His entire being for us, He loved us with His everything. Giving His everything for us. He loved us even when we didn't love Him. In 1 John, that same 4th chapter, verses 19, we see, we love because He first loved us. It is not we who loved Him first. It is He who loved us first. Romans 5, verses 8, very familiar portion says, But God shows or demonstrates His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. He loved us while we were still unlovable. That is the true love of God. That is agape love. And that is the love with which God wants us to love Him. That is the love that has to get into us. That is the love we have to understand so that we can love Him that way. That's why, you know, Paul understood that, and Paul is praying this prayer for the Ephesians. 3 verses 14 onwards, we see, For this reason I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named, that according to the riches of His glory, He may grant you the strength with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love, rooted and grounded in love, that you may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth, what is the length, what is the height, and what is the depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. So Paul is praying this prayer for the Ephesians, saying that I am praying that you may be able to comprehend, that you will be rooted and grounded in this love. That you will be able to comprehend the breadth, the length, the height and depth of this love. You will understand this love in your life. This is what God is desiring from us. That God loved us with His entire being. That He did everything for us, and each day He wants us to understand His love more in our life so that we can put that into practice when we love Him. That is the love. The word agape is used in Greek. The word ahab is used in Hebrew, which means it's a desire to be
In the presence of the object of love, it's a strong affection, it's a strong attachment. Agape love means you prize it above all other things. You take pleasure in it, you enjoy it. You are unwilling to abandon it. You want it somehow. You want that love. You want to be with him. That is what God is desiring from us, that we love him with all our being. With lack of time, I don't want to go into all the details. Maybe if time permits, we'll do it sometime later. But God wants us to love him with our entire being, with all our soul, with all our heart, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Are we ready to do that for Christ? Are we ready to follow him completely? Can we close our eyes? Can we say that, Jesus, you did everything for me. You did everything for me. You suffered on the cross for me. You gave your entire being for me, Lord Jesus. And my response to love you is not because of the miracles that you did for me, or because of something that you are going to give me, because of the prayers that you are going to answer me. But my love to you is in response to what you already did for me. Is our love for him enduring? Is our love getting cold based on circumstances? That when we go through some pains in our life, when certain prayers are not getting answered in our life, is our love getting cold? When we go through certain sicknesses in our life, is our love getting cold? When we lose a job, is our love getting cold? Is our love conditional that, God, if you do this, I will love you. If you give me this job, I will love you. If you give me this promotion, I will love you. God loved us unconditionally. And he has already given us everything. There is nothing that he need to give us to prove that he loves us. There is nothing, absolutely nothing that he needs to give us to prove that he loves us, because he has already given us everything. Can we say that, Jesus, you have already given me everything. In response to that, I'm loving you, Lord Jesus. With all my being, with my entirety, with everything that I have, with everything that you have given me, with all my talents, with all my gifts, Lord, with all the strength that I have, Lord, I want to love you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Can we stand up in his presence and sing this old hymn? My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. Jesus, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, it is now. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin my gracious Redeemer, my Savior, I love. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, tis now. I love first loved me.
Lord Jesus, let our love not be based on selfish ambition, Lord. Lord, what we do in our life, the actions that we do in our life, let it not be to show others, Lord. Let us not be hypocrites like Pharisees and Sadducees were, Lord. But Lord, help us to love you, Lord, because of what you did for us, Lord Jesus. Just based on what you did for us, Lord, on the cross of Calvary, Lord. Let all our relationships be based on that agape love, Lord. That our love with our family, with our wife, with our children, with our colleagues, Lord, the love with our neighbors, loving others, Lord, and loving God, everything be based on that agape love, Lord Jesus, that you showed for us, Lord, by giving yourselves up for us, Lord. That our love be like that, Lord, that we will be ready to give ourselves up, Lord. That Jesus said, as you said, Lord, greater love is none than giving life for the brothers. That we will be ready, Lord Jesus, to give ourselves up, Lord, because you did it for us, Lord Jesus. Help us, Lord, to understand your love more in our life, Lord, that we will be able to grasp the height, the depth, the width of that love, Lord Jesus, in our life. That we will grow in that love, Lord Jesus. That our love will not grow cold, Lord Jesus, but our love will be increased every day with each and every experiences in our life, Lord Jesus. As we go through our struggles in our life, as we go through our pains in our life, Lord, we will get closer to you, Lord. Our love will become stronger and stronger, Lord Jesus. Not because of our efforts, Lord, but because of what you will enable us to do, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for all your blessings in our life, Lord Jesus. Thank you for that amazing love that you showed us, Lord Jesus. And help us, Lord, not to just follow some rules and principles and commandments, Lord, but let this be our basis, Lord Jesus, that we do everything because of love. And it will be a joy for us, Lord, to spend time with you, Lord. That we will not, hallelujah, our spending time with you will be out of our love for you. That it will not be out of compulsion, or it will not be out of someone telling us to do that, Lord. But it will be out of our love for you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this wonderful time that you've given us, Lord. All glory and honor be to you alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.